and see what you can find.
With your book, your car, wherever you are.
Tuned in, signals clear. Coming through, geocache talk. A voice on the line I hear. Coming through, geocache talk.
Well, hey everyone, it's time for Geocache Talk. Whether you're at work, in the car, wherever you are, we hope you enjoy the show. Please get like and subscribe on iTunes, Stitcher, Overcast, Radio Public, Spotify. You can get all the weekly Geocache Talk goodness. Big thanks to the Travel Bugs for the music and our patrons, Demon Hunter 2, Aggie Jedi Master, Electric Water Boy, Antaeus, Joshua the Geocaching Vlogger, Nick at Cashley, One Kind Word, Butterfly Girl, Loon Trackers, The Aussie Geocacher, Sodak Zach, The Deadliest Cachers, Terrell 2, Neil Moore, Team D&D, Geocaching Adam, Peachy 1276, The No Code Geocachers, Curiosity Girl, Tick Magnet, Marsipanic, Bricker John, Firesafe, FS Abero, Geo Rick, Cash Addict Mel, Geocaching Janji, The Geocaching Junkie, Sir Dremelot, Janice, Tricassius, Tom Frey, Rugals, The Bruce Zero, EGK PBR, Casamaya, Master Sergeant, USMC, Little Gears, Albedo 0.39, It's Only Barney, Purple Turtles 3, ACDC Family, None of It Tidy, AFK Geocaching, Josh Boggs, Carrot Killer, Corsgat, Geocaching with Lampe, Bryn Tim 07, Dave and Karen of Cache Canada, Team Tailwagger, Black Chrome, Supernate, The Twonky, Burnt Turtles, Padib, Kazeli, Dragon, Gunter Hunters, Acme Wild Cachers, P0001, ADK Sarah, and our new patrons, Eastern Girls, KC, Billy Robson, Fox and the Hound, TX Wolf Totem, K-Blast, Landlock Pirate Fam, Statuki, Burns Fire, Hockey Zombie, Ship to Shore, and A. Holly S. Okay, deep breath. If you'd like to become a patron, head on over to patreon.com/geocachetalk for more details. Patrons get X tags, new blackout coins. Ooh, check out the blackout coin right there. And other geocaching items during the year. Put bonus content, invites to special events only for patrons. Support levels start at as little as $3 a month. Well, let me welcome my co-host, Jesse. I have to refer to you tonight as Memphis Mafia most of the night.
And I lose my name every time somebody comes on the show with the same name. So.
I know.
But I'll take it. Memphis is fine.
We're going to defer to the other Jesse tonight.
Defer, so, yes.
There you go.
The better Jesse is on the show. So
right.
I get relegated to Memphis. So.
That's right. You're relegated. All right. Let's jump to it. We got a lot tonight. Let's jump on the show 110 for August 5th. As we welcome to the show, Scott Berks and Shorty Knits. Welcome to the show. Welcome to Geocache Talk.
Hello. How are you?
Good. Great to have you guys on.
Like a bell.
I know. What was that? I know. No, we're ringing the bell for Scott.
Scott, just in anticipation of
right,
tonight.
In anticipation. We're ringing that bell. We're going
to
do something.
I've been warned to keep my vocabulary at bay, so I will do my best.
Yes, if I have to, then so do you. It's not fair.
we're not letting you get away with it. But we really looking forward to this. We've known Scott and Jesse, for a while, and I was a big fanboy back in the day. Always listening and love listening to Scott and Daryl and Andy and Corey or different people. But I kind of really enjoyed it. It got me interested. And I've told Scott this before. It really got me interested in podcasting, and he's been a great help. And I really appreciate you guys coming on. We got an interesting topic tonight. I really felt like this was a good topic to talk to you guys about, because you're a little bit seasoned in geocaching.
A little bit seasoned.
How many?
I just hit my 10-year mark.
I was going to ask you. That's awesome. Yeah. 10 years. Jesse,
it came and went like nothing. It was right. Like nothing.
How about you, Jesse? You're like a couple years behind Scott? No.
Yeah. I started in 2011. So that's right. I just hit 7 years last month or 2 months ago.
That's awesome.
Which is the same as when I started. And if you look at the numbers, she has totally blown me out of the water.
Mm-hmm.
Not that we were racing or anything, but looks like I had just started 2 years ago compared to.
Yeah. I had a couple of big years where that was pretty much all I did. I think I had like 3,500 one year, like 2,500 the next year.
Sure.
And the past 2 years, it's been nothing. So I've slowed way down. I am going to hit 10,000 next weekend when we go up to West Bend for the Cash Bash.
Cash Bash. Oh, neat.
That's pretty cool.
Cash Bash.
I'll hit. Planning to make like Cash Bash the 10,000, the event, or
I'm hoping to. What I've been doing actually is each of my official geocaching.com milestones, I've tried to make a different icon. Mm-hmm. So I don't have a mega event yet. So I'm hoping that I can work it out. I got to figure out how many I found this weekend and try to make it my 10,000.
How picky are you of it actually being the exact number?
You know, not within a few here and there.
Yeah. I ain't even going to lie. I'm not. I'll just log a lot of when I get back for the weekend and be like, yep, that's the 10,000. I took my picture.
Exactly. Right. It's going to be the mega.
Not that I've got 10,000, but I mean at milestones, you know. But
and I'll hit 16 there, but I don't care. So it'll probably be a parking grab.
Scott stopped caring about his milestones after 10.
After 10, I don't care anymore.
Well, until you get to like 20, there's not another big milestone for a long time.
Right.
I didn't care much for 15 either. So it's all this. But it's what's funny is that like what we've noticed is as our kids, we have three kids, and as our kids get older, it gets harder to cash. You think it'd get easier to cash.
No.
But no, it gets harder.
Yeah.
You know, like. Everybody who listens to podcasts at all knows my infamous, you know, every summer I'm off because I got baseball. You know, we had three kids. We had 88 games of baseball in 3 months. You know, that's baseball, man. I mean, and I coached, what, 3 out of the 5 teams? Like, I coached 2/3 of those games, you know. So it's a lot of baseball, and there's no time. It's like we'd have 2 games a day on Saturday and Sunday. You know, so there's no time to cash. So it's slowed us down. You know, like what's funny, the topic today, I don't know if you announced what the topic was, but like the topic is that's when our caching gets started.
Yep, absolutely.
Right.
That's when we really get going. You know, like the beginning of the summer is pretty much quiet for us because we have so much baseball going. I bet we'll get one here and there. I like to go out at lunch like you do and go get a cache at lunch, you know, my lunch. But that's about it, you know. I mean, weekends, like, I think we had a couple of nights where we got like 30 in one night and went out, you know, we had a airport free time, you know, like no kids, no games, no nothing, you know.
A rarity. Yeah. So as we talk about the problem with the Googles before, we never had this happen before, but apparently the show has died. I don't know what happened, but nobody can log in right now.
Oh, no.
Except
nobody
for
can log into the show?
No. It's a never-ending circle for folks. But that's, I mean, we're recording it, so we're just going to continue on. I mean, there's not much else we can do. I don't want to restart it. But, yeah, everybody was, that's why we usually have about 30 viewers or more, and we're down to 0 tonight. So
they're in the chat room.
Nobody cares.
The chat room's saying it's, yeah.
No.
Berks
is on for Gail.
Yeah, exactly. No, not that. Just kind of weird. It's just people are saying it didn't help. It's just getting a never-ending circle. So I don't know. Should we? I don't know if we can stop and start. Or we got 6 viewers. It's picking up.
Anybody can see the
6:11. It's picking up. So okay, it looks like it's got fixed.
Maybe they had to quit the browser.
13. It's fixing itself. So we're in good shape. We went from 0
Some
back
of them
up.
Still can't see it, so hopefully.
Hopefully. We went from 0 to 13. We're back up to 14. Okay. We're going to continue on now with the weird stuff. I don't know if, Scott, I told you about, we had Ansley Gordon on with the movie Treasure. This is back before I was just doing this show solo. And I'm kind of nervous. I've got a Hollywood actress on the show, and I'm trying to be you know, be slick, and we're showing her commercials and different things like that. And what do? I clicked, instead of clicking the stop sharing button, I clicked the stop broadcast button. I killed the show. So I rushed around and got another show set up, and I got them back in there, and it was a mess. But anyway, all right, we're just gonna keep going, and hopefully people.
So just so you know, the chat room says it. Most of them are saying that it's just frozen.
Okay. Hmm.
Can they hear it?
I guess
not. I don't think so.
We're recording, and YouTube is recording, so.
Yeah. I'm just going to see if any of them are able to log in and back out. And
yeah, keep
maybe
trying.
An audio show, which is.
It happens.
The intention, but if we have to do it that way, we do it that way, right?
Yep. All right, well, we got some news. We've been doing the. We got our new promotion going on, the Geocache Talk Stash. Giving out clues. We have to be very careful what we say because people are hanging on a lot of stuff we say because they're trying to figure out how many there are in the lower 48. And they're starting to figure, you know, the first two weeks just clues that were related to all of the stashes. And then tonight will be the first clue for Geocache Talk Stash number one. We're calling it number one for tonight. And that clue is published in the episode. That's all we're going to say about that. So, right?
It is, but if this is only an audio show, that'll be a problem.
Well, no, YouTube's recording, I think. I don't think we're having a problem with that. If not, we'll get the clue out one way or the other. So it's going to be fine.
I'm an audio guy.
Yeah, there you go. We'll work something out. We'll get the clue out. So I was contacted this week by Wayne Borman. He lives in England. He knows that he's not able to be a part of this first round of the Geocache Talk Stash because, well, he can, but he'd have to come to the lower 48. He had to cross the pond for that. But he really wanted to be involved. So he's sending us a 3D printed cache to add to our pile of loot that's in there. So I thought that was kind of cool to have him do that. So I appreciate him wanting to get involved. And, you know, if anybody else wants to get involved, you definitely can. We're up to 19, so I think we're starting to. It's starting 19, to work itself out.
19 things of loot?
19 viewers. I was looking back at the viewer thing. Sorry. No, we got a lot of loot, Scott. Yeah. So we've got a couple.
Come on.
Yeah.
We got a couple. That's a lot of loot.
We do have a lot of loot in there. We got a couple books.
We actually do have a lot of loot in there. So already, and there's several things that are going in that we haven't announced yet.
It's like a bucket of loot with 19.
It is. It's a whole. Mm-hmm. We got coins. We got a coin from. Chris Mackey coin in there. We've got books. We've got other stuff in there, and we just keep adding every week. What's that? Go ahead, Scott.
Are the Gary Slinkard books?
Well, we got one of Geocaching Janji's. We got her children's book.
Oh,
so,
nice.
Yeah, Sophia Finds a Geocache. Mm-hmm. That was Angie's book. So yeah, we're adding.
Back there'll be some other. Geocaching related yearly memberships in there and some other things that'll be in there before it's all over.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah.
And maybe even some bigger things that we can't say yet. We got to spread it out a little bit, right? You got to build up the anticipation.
Exactly. Sure. Exactly. All right. A couple other notes of news before we get into the topic tonight. Did you guys happen to see this published note about geocache that swam the English Channel?
I did see that story.
I did, yes.
Okay.
Did you read it, though?
I read it.
I did.
I think she might have told me.
I admit I did not. I saw the email. Okay. I was like, oh, it's cool. Read it later. I never got to it.
It's okay. Yeah, it was found over in England, actually, and they think it's from Jersey, which is this little island off the coast of France, which has its own cool story. It's actually part of... It's not part of France, but it's right off the coast of France. That's a whole other story, a whole other show. Which, by the way, when I say that, if you had a beverage around, you can drink. That's kind of what we do with that. So
did headquarters automatically log it because it's a locationless cache? I mean, archive it.
Archive it, exactly.
It, like, immediately, bloop, gone. Can't do that.
No, yeah. No, what they did was they let the boy who found it keep it, and the person who owned the actual cache just put a replacement out for it.
But what kind of container was it?
Just a little camo, like a pill bottle, I think, wasn't it? Let me
double check. Pill bottle made it all the way over there, and they identified it?
Yeah.
I was thinking it was bigger than that. I thought it was a lock and lock.
Maybe a lock and lock. I think Jesse's right.
Was floating?
It did. It floated all the way across the ocean.
On the shore, on the other side of the channel.
Wow.
Yeah, across the channel.
That's pretty impressive.
Yep.
That's pretty amazing.
And the kid took it to school.
Yeah.
Did he know what it was? Did he know it was a geocache?
The kid didn't know what it was, but he took it to school, and the teacher knew what it was because, I don't know, he or she was a geocacher.
Get out of town.
I'm calling fake news.
Memphis, we should have read this article.
Right.
I'm going to have to go back and read that article now just so I can not believe it.
Right.
Yeah, that's pretty far-fetched. Pretty impressive.
Yeah, I just found one. I'm going to find one next week that floated over from South Africa.
Maybe.
I'm just kidding. I'm sure it's all true.
It's pretty impressive if that's the case. I mean, can you imagine just opening something up and be like, oh my God, this is good. There's a log inside.
So as a marketing guy, Scott, what's your first thought of that? Mine is, if I'm the company that sells that lock and lock, that's going to be a commercial.
Oh my God, yes, that is.
There's no doubt.
Right.
And it was bone dry inside.
That's right.
Like the old commercial with the Samsonite where they give it to the gorilla and he bounced it around the zoo and... He can never get
that's
it open.
That's a perfect one if it's true because it can be backed up. That commercial would
just
be awesome.
Off with that commercial.
I did. Yeah. I did it myself.
Just dating yourself. So horrible.
very much so. Nobody remembers that commercial.
I do.
You do. But you're,
I have hair, dude.
You've got the, yeah, you and I both. We remember it. Oh, crazy. Yeah,
remember OJ running through the airport.
The Hertz commercial.
Sure.
Oh, yeah.
I remember OJ driving away from something. I can't remember what it was, but.
Yeah.
I remember that too.
Okay. So, next item, this Treasure X giveaway. Mm. I don't know. We'll get y'all's opinion on this, but it seemed like we're going too many back-to-back giveaway stuff. And we just did this one.
DuckTales.
The DuckTales one, yeah.
And the Magic one.
Magic the Gathering wasn't too far behind it. And now we've got...
The new one that came?
Yeah, this Treasure X giveaway. It's... I'm probably going to butcher what this thing is. But basically what it is, Scott, is it's a... It's like a... You've probably seen something like this, or the kids have probably been involved maybe in a little bit, something like this. But it's like a little block, and you... chip away at it, and inside of it there's like a treasure. In this case, it's a little miniature,
like a Kinder egg you can't eat.
Yeah, I guess kind of like a Kinder egg, or I know
a
there was
toy inside.
Yeah, a lot of times they'd have these like at science places where you could go and you would dig and you would find an item inside of clay or whatever,
like a fossil.
Like a fossil?
Exactly.
Okay, so is this like a fossil? What are they giving away?
It's kind of like a... Yeah. I told you I was going to ruin this.
Did you sign up for?
Yeah, I submitted to get one.
Did you get one?
No.
I got one.
I got the last one. So
yeah, you got the DuckTales one. Yeah.
Right. So yeah. People who got the last one were automatically excluded.
No way.
I don't know. Well, it seems like I get every other one.
Really?
That's how it seems.
Weird.
That's crazy.
I don't know. I think I did the one before that, and I didn't get anything. I liked it better when they used to like give us the heads up, the podcasters, so we'd get them all.
Right.
It doesn't work like that anymore. Like the first 1,000 get them. That was the best. I got them all.
Totally. Oh, yeah.
Like 3 random drawn. I don't get any of them, though.
So I love to always ask this. When you get it, do you send it out?
Yes.
Nice.
Always.
Good for you.
Yeah, the Michelin Man.
Eventually.
Gone.
Gone.
That one?
Michelin Man.
I got to show this anytime that comes up. See if I got my Michelin Man
Where's
in here.
Memphis?
mine's gone.
Memphis
no,
sent
no,
his,
I sent mine out.
Memphis sent his out.
2 years later, it came back to me.
Came all the way back, and it wasn't – it came back to him. We were at the Texas Challenge, and they didn't know that Memphis was even going to be there. And
really?
Yeah, and a friend of mine was like, I got his Michelin Man. Let me bring it. And he
and
had
been
it
out there for at least 2 years in the wild, maybe more.
And he had it. He's like, I didn't know he was going to – I mean, because that was the year – it was his past year, and we didn't really – you Memphis decided at the last minute that he was going to make the trip, so he really hadn't told anybody. And right. Sure enough, he showed up. Sometimes
they do. Most of them just disappear immediately once they're gone, right?
Golly,
yeah. People take them and they keep them for themselves. Like, oh, look, I got one now.
Yeah. They're gone.
Every other one that I've ever sent out disappeared.
Yeah, but that one made it.
And the what was the one that was the book promotion? It was gold. I can't remember.
Or was it the piece of gold one? Yeah, the Jeff James Patterson one or something like that.
Yeah, it? Yeah. I actually found my own in a cache at the end of a multi, and I got there, and it was there.
Can you grab that, please? You know what I found in a cache?
Uh-oh.
Did you find the tin cup?
I found this in a cache.
The tin cup.
Nice.
Tin cup whiskey.
I sent mine out, and it disappeared.
Do you know what I got with this guy? What this tin cup?
His was a special tin cup.
I got $2,000 with this.
Oh, that's right. You did.
I got a gold coin.
Oh, nice. That's right.
Yeah.
So did you get an actual physical gold coin?
I got a physical gold coin. It's in the lockbox, or I'd show it to you. That's
all
the
way that is awesome.
That is cool.
But yeah.
Way to tell everyone where it is.
People do, yeah.
But this is the actual. I kept this because this one gave me a couple grand. So this one stays on my shelf.
Yeah. That one you got to keep.
Yeah, everything else I immediately go. In fact, a funny story is that like when the Chicago Geocacher podcast, which some of you may have heard, ended, we gave away coins. We minted coins for that to help pay offset costs for the 100th final show and stuff like that. It was a big, huge live ordeal.
Right.
And me and Walt both got a bunch of coins. And so I threw out four coins into the wild.
Wow.
All my coins are on the wild. They all made maybe two caches before people passed, right? But one of them kept going and survived and lived and lived and lived and lived. And then 2 years ago, was it? It was
a few years after they went out.
Oh, yeah. It was at least 2 years.
4 years from.
I saw Joshua at West Bend.
Right.
Geocaching vlogger. And he goes, guess what I got?
Oh,
I said,
my
what?
Gosh. No way.
He got the coin. He's got
the coin. That's crazy.
Someone gave it to him and said, if you see Scott Berks, he's like, I'm going to see him. He's like, give him this coin. So he gave me back the coin, which I said, thank you. And I gave it back to Joshua. And he took it to Japan and dropped it in Japan.
Wow.
That's the first time I ever held an actual, like,
right.
I got my, 2 years later, I got my coin back.
You got it back in your hand. That's crazy.
And I gave it back to him and said, go put it someplace else.
This one has five different, there's King, Gold Crown, Gold Fin, Gold Blade, Pharaoh, Loot, and Treasure X trackable. I don't know what all those are, but I guess we'll find out. Memphis says he got one. I got one. Supposed to be here Monday, so.
Oh, both got one. You both got one.
Yeah.
And did you get the DuckTales one?
We did. Yeah. We got a
box of DuckTales ones.
We got a whole bag of those things. We got lucky.
I'm not on the A-list.
You're on the C-list.
We're going to get you guys back on the A-list soon. William, we're going to talk about that a little bit, too. So make sure you guys get back on that list.
Well, that was the first question within 1 minute on the thing that we're going to talk about later. It was within 1 minute, that was the first question.
The first question is, what's going on with Geocaching Podcast?
Yeah. Wonder what we're going to talk about tonight.
What makes you think I know?
Oh, no. We're going to ask that in a little bit. But all right. We're going to skip the next one because I'm not quite sure about all that. We're just going to jump right into the notes. We've got plenty to talk about. So, or the topic, I'm sorry. Virtual rewards. Let's finish up with virtual rewards because that's kind of interesting. Go ahead.
So virtual rewards, we're up to 1982 out of 4,000, which obviously begs the question, where are those other 2018? Why are you not pushing them out there? I just don't know why you wouldn't do it.
You soulless people, who are you?
And here's the thing that I'd like to know. Of course, we'll never know, right, who didn't put theirs out there. But, you know, reviewers got them. Surely they put theirs out.
Right.
All reviewers got one. I don't know. I just nobody's going to tell them themselves.
Everybody
like,
who I know who got one, put them out. Everybody I know.
Yeah.
I don't know that many people. Well, one anyway, but like, everyone I know put one out.
Right. Well, here's the interesting thing. And actually, Scott and I talked about this, actually, if you remember this, Scott. When this first came out last year, we had a discussion about this. We're like, why did, and I think we both kind of either knew somebody or we'd heard about that. Why did X get one?
Yeah, I got people who had no business getting one.
Right. Yeah. Because there was like, they had like three caches.
Right. Like no fines. Like, yeah. And I get one.
Yeah.
Like, it looked like random, like literally a random crapshoot.
Did you guys get one?
No.
I did not. No.
That's...
And I only have, 15,000 fines. And
yeah.
That's a crime.
Over 100 hides, but no, I didn't get one.
I wonder what the algorithm was for that. I know they won't share it, obviously.
It was a bad algorithm. I can tell you that right now. I can tell you, and that's not because I didn't get one. That wasn't my point. It's like people like Scott didn't get one. People, and it just doesn't make any sense. But and then go ahead, Jesse.
Yeah. We knew someone who hadn't found a cache in like a year and a half or something.
Right.
That didn't make any sense.
Yeah.
It doesn't make any sense.
That's wild.
And here's what we got. We've got maybe half, and that doesn't make any sense that we,
So again, is that a comment on their algorithm or people not caring about putting them back out?
Well, the question is, if, like Jesse said, if you got somebody who hasn't found a cache in a year and a half, how many of those, 1,000 still left or 2,000? How many are still left out there? Roughly 1,000, roughly?
Mm-hmm. 2,018.
How many of those left? Are the people who don't even cache anymore?
Mm-hmm. Right.
Or sock puppet accounts or throwaway. Right.
Literally, a couple hundred of those probably.
On the flip side, there's now almost 2,000 more virtual caches for us to go and get. And I got one this morning that was from last year. So
very cool.
Yeah.
Some of them are done pretty well, too. Let me tell you why it's not very cool, okay? It's because the last 4 years, there's an Illinois virtual challenge where you have to go through the entire state of Illinois. And if you don't know, Illinois is a very large state. Not as large as Texas, but, it's a big state. And, everyone that came out is all down south. It's all, six. Mm-hmm. Me and Jesse were
so... We were four finds away from getting every single one in all of Illinois.
And it's a challenge guess, a 5-5 challenge guess. Mm-hmm. We've been working on it for 4 years.
And then all the new ones came out and
dang it.
Get it.
We have one here too that's a virtual matrix challenge. So of all the ones in Colorado, you have to fill in only part of the matrix was there, right? From all the old virtuals.
Right.
But now he's been updating as people add more to it. You have to add more. I wasn't even done before.
Yeah,
because it was like Long's Peak where people die every year going up on it and all these things. And I figured over the next 6-7 years, if I continue caching, I could slowly get to it. And now virtuals are popping up and it's added. Awesome. There's no way.
It killed us. I mean, we were so close to getting it. It's really frustrating. Well, what are you going to do?
That's bad.
It's hard to argue for bringing virtuals back out if less than half of the people even that got a chance to do them, did it.
Yeah. I love virtuals. And we always get them. If we see them, we stop and get them.
Absolutely.
We always stop and get them wherever they are. So
do you think that would be the same, though, if they were as common as traditionals? Because they're not as much fun to me. My wife really likes them. But
We go to virtuals because there's not a lot of them.
Right.
But if there were a lot, I think we still would because usually they're pretty quick and easy.
Yeah, they're really easy. Yeah. Snap a picture, What's funny is that somebody asked me if I get it, what would I do? Where would I put it? I'm like, right. Wrigley Field. You think I'd put it? I put a Wrigley freaking field. And of course, now there's one at Wrigley Field. Somebody did.
Yeah. That's awesome. Wrigley.
Yeah. I guess that means I have to go back.
You got to take a picture in front of the sign. The Wrigley sign? The red.
Oh, yeah. Very famous sign. Yep.
Hey, I've got one. Can I just go ahead and claim it? Is that how that works?
Mm-mm. You can try.
That's for another show.
You look like 3 years younger. What's going on?
You got to do a thumbs up. You have to do a thumbs up in the picture, I think.
Nice.
Yeah. So
that's kind of cool. So it's very specific kind of thing.
So all right. Cheat.
Right. Right. Exactly. All right. Let's get into the discussion. End of summer geocaching. And what I kind of want to discuss, and I kind of want to get you know, Scott and Shorty Knits' perspective, and also get Memphis's perspective, because his is going to be a little bit different. But
All of us are in really different areas of the country.
We are. And I think we kind of think about the fall maybe a little bit differently. And so I guess we'll start. I want to start with Scott and Jesse. And I know for you guys, you had such a busy summer that you're kind of in a good area, right? Because school hasn't started, and you're done with baseball, so you have kind of like this window, right?
Yes, we have a window.
I know Jesse's the planner on the in this.
Oh, absolutely, 1,000%, 1,000. But one of the is we're a blended family, you know, and. Yeah. One of the, you know, I always say like divorce totally sucks, but one of the good things about divorce is every other weekend you don't have your children,
right?
You know, and Jesse and I were lucky enough where our kids go to their significant others, our exes, at the same time. So we have 1 weekend all kids, 1 weekend no kids, 1 weekend all kids, 1 weekend no kids. And we have no kids. Oh my, forget about it. You know, like we're gone. You know, right.
That's awesome.
But, yeah. Okay. But it's now, but then of course, the beginning of summer stinks because of baseball. Like as I said earlier, like the older they get, the harder it is, you know, like now the kids are getting older and they're all three of them are playing baseball,
right?
You know, sanity. And so, but now like our caching season begins now.
Yep.
Like this is when our caching in late July and August is when our caching summer season actually begins.
I think May and June are like our lowest.
Oh yeah.
Fine. Oh, month and August.
Is our
July
largest.
And August are
our biggest. Yeah,
because you're in a because like when, and I know you guys are different than the normal geocacher, but when the weather starts to really turn, when's the weather get to be for you guys even where you kind of go, oof, it's rough out there today. November.
Never.
It's not. I mean, really, the only time that we wouldn't go out if weather based on the weather is in the storm, like in a big blizzard, snowstorm or something. But I mean, we even go caching in the snow.
Sure,
you just have it's Jewel just
caching
different.
Day.
It's
Come
just
on,
different.
Man.
Oh yeah, of course. We'll have to mention that in a minute too. I love hearing about what goes on that day because it's crazy.
The weather changes in Chicago in about late October. Mm-hmm. Late October is when it starts to get cool and crispy and you're like brr, you know, like that's when it really starts to hit.
So
that's
you put on a couple extra layers in your boots and you still go out to
suck
the woods.
It up and you go to the
there's
woods.
No snow on the ground, you can still find stuff
and see everybody thinks it gets cold in Colorado. It gets really cold in Chicago compared to here. It gets colder there than it does here for sure.
But the beauty, you know, I've said it many times on the Geocaching podcast, the beauty part of Chicago is it's not the woods aren't going to kill you. There's nothing in the woods that can kill you. Urban caching will kill you.
That's right.
But the woods, there's nothing in the woods. There's no bears. There's no rattlesnakes. It's like deer. Yeah. Deer and raccoons are in the woods. And that's it, you know. So, like, I'm not afraid to stick my hand, you know, into a hollow tree. You know, I have no problems with that. Now, I have problems urban caching at night.
Right.
I have issues with. But
right.
How you end up with a gun in your face like you have before.
I have.
Oh, my gosh. But going after Beverly, you could do that any time of year.
Absolutely. Unless there's 3 feet of snow on the ground. Well, but even then.
You can still do it. But
you can still do it.
Find.
Bring a couple and you're fine.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, that's all.
Do the two of y'all, when you, do you see where there's maybe, and I know Jesse does a lot of planning on these kind of things, but do you plan for, like, will you see a cache, you're like, this is going to be a little tougher. Maybe it'd be better to do this during the day instead of at night. And then, of course, you get less. Once you get closer to winter, you're getting less sun. So, do you kind of go through a process of that, or do you not really? Is the planning not that specific?
No, I mean, I think really. There are caches that we actually wait to go find in winter because lakes and rivers freeze around here.
Right.
And it makes five fives on an island a heck of a lot easier.
Simple.
Yep.
So, you know, I mean, winter caching definitely has its advantages.
Oh, sure.
As far as now we just maybe cache in different areas, maybe do more urban caching rather than going into the woods or,
right.
Although we've been known to go into the middle of the night.
I was in the woods Friday night. Me and Cody Dog were in the woods Friday night at 10 o'clock. We're in the woods. So
right.
You know, I have no problem doing it. You know, I have a really good flashlight. You know,
yeah. Yeah. Well, good. So,
do you hold on to a couple near your house? We try to always keep a couple just in case near the house.
I don't anymore. I don't have any.
I did. Oh, yeah. And I needed 37 caches on the last day of the Hidden Creatures promotion. And guess what?
You wiped out your stash, your extras. Yep.
Well, you know, I was saving them for a day that I needed them. And
there you go.
I needed them. I got my World Turtle souvenir for whatever that means.
For the record, I did not get the World Turtle souvenir.
No, that's okay. Well,
I'm okay with it. I'm very okay with it. That's all right.
Because I don't think any of us are working. You guys aren't working on a streak. Memphis gave up on streaks long ago.
Well, no, I have my FDF streak.
Okay.
Are you still doing that?
113 months.
Oh, my gosh.
100?
Like 9 years.
13 months. Of an
that's
FDF.
Awesome.
At FDF, at least one FDF a month for 113 months.
How close have you come to not, like,
the night? The 31st. Oh, I've come close.
Oh, my.
Yes. Very, very close. Yes, very, very close. But like then I've gotten one on the first of the next month, too, which is awesome.
You don't right.
Have to worry about it.
Yes. You
know, like, I don't have it yet this month, but I'll get it. I mean, it was a lot harder. Used to live further away in the where like no caches came out. Now I'm in an area back where I lived before I met Jesse, and there's like
right.
caches on, you know. So I'll get it. I'm not too worried about it. But it's only what, the fifth, sixth? What's the date?
Yeah,
fifth?
It's the fifth.
Plenty of time.
But,
I don't. I'm at this 9 years in. How long am I gonna? I wanted to end at 100 is what I planned to do, and then like one came out like literally in my backyard. I'm
gotta
like,
keep going. Gotta keep going. Someday it'll organically, Scott, it's just going to organically kind of just end probably. And you go, wow, it was a good run, but.
Dude, it's been since what? January 2009.
Wow.
Longer than I've been caching, by the way.
Here's the funny part is I got one in November of 2008, but I didn't get one in December of 2008. So it could have been an even.
Oh, gosh. Incredible. That is incredible.
Yeah, it took years before I even realized it was still going. I didn't even pay attention to it. You know, it just
right. You went back and looked. You're like, I'm still going.
I'm still going. Yeah.
We're gonna segue.
Kind of helps too that you live near a large urban area.
Oh, I'm sure yeah. that well,
a lot yeah. of active cachers and you know.
Yeah, right, mm-hmm. Makes it a lot easier. Yeah.
If you live in a town of like 30,000, you're probably not gonna keep a 10-year streak of FTFs going.
Yeah, we lived before. Like I said, we moved back here a year ago, but we lived about 40 miles away. From where we live now, and it's a waste barren of, you know, no caches mm-hmm. come out, barely any caches there, and mm. it was very difficult. I thought for sure when I moved out there, the streak's over. I can't believe I kept it going for the 4 years that we lived out there, you know. Right.
That is incredible.
Yeah, I thought no way, you know. So,
but that just shows that like it's a normal part of your routine for both of y'all. You know,
Jesse had
it
going
down the winter. You're not missing the FTFs. You're doing it year round.
Oh yeah, we don't stop. Yeah, it doesn't. I mean, we'll cash in the winter. Yep. It's just, I mean, Gary, I don't think you've ever cashed in the winter, right?
No, I mean, I've found caches that in cold weather, but not
right. But you don't.
Not what we're talking about. No, games. Yeah.
The game changes very much.
It does. You're right.
It's a totally different game. You know.
Oh, and, yeah.
You know, I change my pack. I change my cut. That you know, mm-hmm. the things in the trunk of my car flip.
Oh, yeah.
You know, the whole right. game changes. You know, so it's. So it's just a different game. That's all, you know.
Right.
Yes.
Well, and
I actually have to have a shovel just to get to an LPC sometimes.
I'm sure. I have a shovel in my trunk in the wintertime. Absolutely. Yeah, right. I have a little portable little shovel.
Collapsible shovel.
Yeah, the little like the Army, you know, Boy Scout shovel that flips out and puts a little patch.
The rubber mallet. We that's rubber like mallets. A lifesaver, dude.
Oh yeah.
The LPC is a frozen LPC. Ding, ding, ding. Good to go, man.
That's awesome.
And a metal walking stick so you can, you know.
Oh, yes. You listen for the clank.
You, like, push down into the snow, you know, bang down into the snow.
Oh, right. Find it. Yeah.
So you hear the sound difference.
That's right. Different.
I think we found it. It's there. Yep. There it is. That ammo, it's like, but it's an ammo can. It's huge. It's like, well, it's an ammo can, but if it's covered in snow, it's going to be hidden. Yeah.
So, Gary, you don't hit up, y'all don't stop even in the winter. And Gary, you don't really go out as much in the winter. There's some areas up here you can't get to during the wintertime. So they'll close off certain roads.
That's true.
Like in the, you know, the backcountry and stuff like that. There's certain roads that just close for part of the wintertime. So those caches, they don't even actually disable them. You just can't get to them.
Yeah. Something we're going to, I'm going to try to do, I've talked to Susan, we're going to try to do is get a little, well, see, now we're in a weird deal because, like we talked about before, like Scott was talking about, I live in a town where we cleared it. There's no caches in town. I haven't had an FTF in my town for like a year because I either own it or I've got it. And nobody else is putting caches out. And I beg people to put caches out in my town. So now my plan, though, is in the fall and winter is to try to do a few more. And of course, like Scott said, I'm doing one. I'm trying to do them during lunchtime at work because now that I work over in the DFW area, there's caches everywhere. So anyway,
a whole new area.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So that helps, but we do try to get out and do caching even in the winter, but I just don't do as well in the winter. But I appreciate what you guys are mentioning because I think that folks, no matter where they live in the northern part of the world or northern part of the U.S., I think that they, if they plan right, I think they could keep going. And I wonder if sometimes they don't maybe just do the planning needed. Yeah.
We've never even considered stopping. We just changed the game.
Change your plans a little bit. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, not even change your plans. It's just you wear more layers of clothing. You know, keep going. No such thing as what's the old saying? It's
there's no such thing as bad weather, just
bad clothing.
Right. Exactly. Yeah.
It really is. I mean,
yeah.
I've cashed in, oh my God, below zero weather before. Mm-hmm. I mean,
oh yeah.
Cool.
No.
Yeah. So we haven't known here about events. Jesse, Memphis, you handed off your weekly coffee, but you guys go year round. You don't stop that.
Yeah, that's around event number 100 on that one. But it's a weekly event. It's 6:30 to 7 a.m.
every Monday
morning. So yeah. We've had a lot of people just coming through town because it's such a staple that they'll come through town and be like, hey, I'm in town with my family and I snuck out of the hotel and got coffee and got to go to an event real quick. And yeah, so I hosted that one for a long time and now I handed that off and somebody else hosts it. But every single Monday morning year round.
So back when you were running it full time, did you ever run into a situation where you're like, we're just not going to be able to make it, or you just kind of buckle up and get it done?
We got a core group of people that if something happened, I've adopted them out before. Like all of a sudden, you know, you host them, you publish them a couple months out, and then hey, I got to go out of town, so I just adopt it out to somebody else, and they'll.
Okay.
There's always some of our core five or six people there, and then we have other people stop in too. So.
Do you guys, Scott or Jesse, do you guys go to a weekly event of any kind, or?
We don't have. We used to have the FLCs here. In the early years, but
we used to have a lot of like regular events, like the Thursday night ice cream socials and the Friday lunch club.
Yeah. Like the FLCs was the big, that was all year.
Yeah. But people don't, we don't have as many events.
No, events have slowed down here in the Chicagoland. I mean, it used to be Saturday nights. They'd be loaded. Mm-hmm. You'd have to pick and choose. Okay. Where am I going to go? Right. Now it's like all during the week. They're not even on Friday and Saturdays anymore. They're like on a Tuesday night. Huh. You know, it's weird how it's just evolved into that, you know?
Right.
And, mm-hmm. Not any more Saturday night ones anymore. You just don't see them anymore.
All right. You've probably seen it change quite a bit over the years, though.
Oh, for sure.
Oh, yeah.
For sure.
Yeah.
Cashers come and go, and games change. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. We're going to get into a couple other topics here in a minute, but this is a good spot for a segue. I know people are asking, and they're going to.
People aren't curious about anything. What are you talking about?
Are you kidding? No, they want to know. Curious minds. Want to know. In fact, like you said, the very first question was
All the rest really tonight, come on, it's just filler. Let's
it's filler. We want to know about the geocaching podcast because Memphis and I we've spent many, many hours listening to Scott and to Andy, and even back in the day when Daryl was with them. And
Daryl. Chad and
yeah,
Sarah.
More recently.
Absolutely.
Right. The hosts have changed a little bit, but still. Is geocaching podcast coming back?
Of course it's.
That's awesome. We're excited about that. Of course. 2.0 kind of, sort of.
I can tell you.
Yeah, tell us what you can.
A lot of stuff is still up in the air. Not in terms of, is it coming back? Yes, it's coming back.
Right.
I'm just trying to figure out. I know what I want to do. Well, first of all, it's now, I'm in charge of the show now. Andy handed it off to me back in May. And he had to bow out. He's having some personal issues. I don't, obviously none of my business to talk about here. You know, right. No business. It's up to him. It has nothing to do with the show. He loves the show. Sure. All the, you know. And he's been awesome. He's did it for 6 years. Oh, trust me.
Yeah,
it's
he was
a podcast. It's
he was a rock. He was a stalwart.
A lot of listeners. A lot. It's huge. It's a huge ordeal. I'm not looking forward to. That being said, I'm changing it. Is what I'm going to do. I'm going to change it. Everything that you know about the show is pretty much going to change. It's not going to go back to Chicago Geocacher. It's not going to become raunchy and just tone it away. I'm not bringing Walt.
You know, first thing, people would love
the
that.
First thing people said was Walt's coming back. Walt's coming back, right? Yeah, you're bringing Walt down.
Right.
No, Walt's not coming on the show.
Not that show.
But I want to bring, like I said, when I wrote my post back in May, I think it was, is I'm going to bring it back to its roots. And, cool. And if you've listened to that show since the beginning, you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
And I want to do that. I really want to bring it back to what it was and what made it a great show and what made it the show that it was. And so I'm trying to figure out in 2018 terms how to pull that off. There is a way to do it. I'm trying to figure it out. It's not cheap.
Right.
Scenes. I'm trying to figure out how to do it. And Jesse and I. Jesse is totally helping me with it as well. So I shouldn't say me.
Yeah.
She's been helping me with thoughts and, you know, running things by her and what she thinks and all that. And she's going to work into the show. And because I want Jesse in it, because I love Jesse.
Yeah.
So you, Jesse, her Jesse, by the way. I'm not talking
about that. You're right. No, we love, and that's why.
I thought I was getting surprise
Scott.
News right there.
I know, exactly. We love that, Jesse, too.
So it's hard to say because I don't want to spill the beans quite yet.
No,
but,
let's keep it. We'll keep it secret. You're right.
But
if you ever need a place to come and spill the beans,
here.
You know, the show you can release that news on.
On normal nights when
we actually have video, I swear we're more professional than this.
Google issues, which we've never had before. I don't think we've ever had this, and this is 110 shows. We've never had something this crazy before, but that's okay.
It's coming back. Yes. Do I know who's coming back with me? I don't know yet. Mm-hmm. I haven't figured out. I haven't talked to either of them yet. Mm-hmm. But we'll see.
Fall, winter, we're kind of thinking.
I would say
somewhere in that range.
Right now?
Yeah.
What do you think, Jess?
Somewhere in there.
Yeah, I'd say.
It depends on how much time we want to put into that as opposed to going out
and geocaching. You got to juggle that sometimes.
I spend way too much time at work researching.
Yeah.
Way too much time at work researching. Way too much time researching stuff and how to pull stuff off. And
how selfish. You want to actually cache and host a geocaching podcast?
So,
maybe 3-4 months.
I'd say less than that.
Maybe.
I'd say less than that. Maybe. I mean, because I'm gonna rehash the website. Everything's getting a makeover. Every single thing is getting a makeover.
You know, if you timed it to launch it at an event you do every year, that would be pretty cool.
What, the geocaching day? Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah.
Oh, that's the only event I do. What else?
Geocaching.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. That'd be.
But that's December. That's way.
People that is. That's a long time from
that
now.
That is quite a ways.
That's like Christmas. I know it's creeping up. Christmas is like 100 and some days away.
Mm-hmm. After the Cubs win the World Series. You can
right.
Start.
Yes. God bless you. God will. So it's coming back. I will be hosting it. Not sure who else is going to be hosting it yet. I have a great idea that I hope works. And like I said in my post, I need everybody in the community to help make this work. It's going to be everybody needs to help. It's not just going to be me. Everybody needs to pull their weight and help me out. And you're going to find out in a couple months what I'm talking about. But it could be really cool. It's something that nobody's done yet. Right. Nobody's done in years, I should say.
We love that.
We hope that we hope it works out. And if it does, I think it'll be pretty cool. It'll be pretty special.
I think it will.
Yeah. You'll get it to work. And it has to work because it's an important part of the whole, you know, geocaching community and the podcast community and everything. So it'll work.
I hope so. You know, I may, by the way, guys, our listeners, I may have spilled the beans to those two guys right there. So
we might know something.
They swore to secrecy. They won't say anything.
We're contractually obligated to not discuss.
That's right.
Anything.
Our life was threatened if we leak anything. So
it's hosting privileges is what it is. So
it is.
I got the privilege because they're up to geocaching podcasting hosts.
That's right. We
appreciate it. It's a small community. So.
It is. We really.
I know who to go to.
Right. Right.
Because not many people know about it. Trust me. Heard about what the plan is. So that's the plan. Unfortunately, guys, I can't tell you more because I don't want to spill the beans, and I got to make sure it can actually work before I actually spill the beans. So you'll know in a couple more months. But trust me, I miss it too. Everyone's in on it. I miss it as well. And every month it goes by, I'm like, my alarm goes off my phone saying podcast. I'm like, oh. Like,
dang it.
Yeah. So I want to get it back too. You know, cool. Get it back up and running again. So
good.
It'll be.
We're looking forward to that. So, all right. Yeah. Couple last topics and then we'll wrap up tonight. So as far as cache placements during, as we transition to fall and then into winter, down here, we don't really think about, do I wait or do I not wait to put out a cache in a certain time of year? Let's go over to Memphis for a minute, and we'll make a round over to Chicago here in a second. But cache placements, do you think at all, Memphis, about what you, as far as like?
Yeah, we have to though in our area because we get a good bit of, now urban stuff you don't really, right? It's either you can place stuff in the city anytime, but when we're doing stuff on the trails or back in the mountains or whatever, you do have to think about that because you could put something out and it could be an area that you can't get to for a while, or, you know, winter friendly, that icon that some people use or some people don't. Mm-hmm. It makes a big difference when you're talking about the mountains and, you know, could have a foot of snow or whatever. So I'll place some in the winter, and sometimes I'll place them and wait to release them later just to make them that much harder. but it really is different, you know. In the city, I can play something anytime I want to, but yeah, backcountry stuff, it's really hard to place one of those in the winter. And once the snow is already kind of packed in and you don't know what the terrain's going to look like once it all dries out.
And you, like you said, placing a cache in for you guys in the winter, it'll look different. Well, even down here a little bit, I noticed, I put out, something like WV Tim had where, it had little clues that were in different around the area. You had to figure out all the clues to open the cache. And when I put it out, it was in the wintertime. And you could, I mean, it was, I had to kind of like be real tricky about putting them out. And when summer came, they like disappeared. You couldn't see them at all because the growth had just like wiped them out.
Oh, yeah.
So like with Scott and Jesse, do you guys, when you put out a cache, do you have to kind of think about like the timing of it a little bit, or do you think about?
Yeah, a little bit. I mean, you have to look at the area. I can't tell you how many times we go, you know, to find a cache and it's like a, you know, 1.5, 1.5 or a 2.2, and you have to walk through overgrowth that's taller than we are to get to it. You look at it and they put it out in March you know, so,
but that's usually a new cacher. Usually cachers don't do that. They know better.
Right.
Exactly. It's actually a 4 terrain, but it's, you know, they've got to mark it as 1.5 because they hit it in January.
Right. All the time. A field. Yeah.
And, you know, surprisingly, that that winter friendly icon helps all the time because
Good for you guys.
Find a cache. Mm-hmm. It could be summertime, and I'm like, oh, it's not winter friendly. But what that tells you is that it's
on the ground.
No, it's up.
No, not winter friendly.
Sorry, if it's winter on the friendly, ground. That
winter
means
friendly.
It's
up. Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that helps because you know, you don't know where you're looking. You know, so a lot of times that icon helps.
Oh yeah, I didn't think about that.
Any time of the year, you know. Yeah.
Is that
your good tree hides make a big difference too, right? Depending on what kind of tree it is, you may be able to spot it really good in the winter sometimes. if it's the right type of tree, and then summertime it's all filled with leaves and you can't see it.
When it's a bison in a tree, oh my God, in the wintertime you walk right up to it.
Yeah.
20 minutes. And
right.
I'm not talking about pine tree. Pine trees stink all year round. But yeah, like, right. A regular tree that's a pull down or something like that. Yeah, you'll spot it right away.
Spot it, right.
And, you know, you go catching in November. Oh my God. It's like you're in the woods, you walk right up to the stuff. Mm-hmm. You know, it's so easy to do. But then you've also got, I mean, the caches I found actually frozen in a tree, you know, like you
put in the project. Can't open it, bang frozen. On it a little bit, right?
Yeah. You're in the middle of the woods and you're banging that thing against the tree.
Trying to get it to open.
Yeah. There are a lot of caches that maybe I don't find, you know, because it's so grown up around the in that area. And so I'll make a mental note. Come back in the winter.
We've done that many times.
Remember,
I say to Jesse, like, we got to come back in the winter. Oh, we got to come back in the summer. You know, like, come back in wintertime.
Right. Yeah. Right. I'll admit I've destroyed more than one cache because it's very brittle. It's, you know, it's 10 below, and I really want to get this up. Oh, man.
Snap that lap.
I feel bad.
Snap that lock and lock in half once it gets brittle.
Some caches are not made for really, really cold weather.
Yeah. But, like, we also, Jesse had one. Jesse put this cache out. God bless you, Jess. I love you. She put this cache out on an island in thorn bushes.
Oh,
that, like, so hello. Not only got to get to the island, but then it's thorn bushes. Mm-hmm. Yep. But it was easy in the wintertime.
Yep.
When we placed it, we just walked across the water.
Yeah.
No thorns or leaves on the bush. We just attached it to it. Oh my God, it's a nightmare. In the
and I waited until
She waited till spring to put it out.
Spring to
nice. Right. Live, so.
Well, I did one. We have the was it the Splains River that or the Fox River?
No, the Fox River.
We have this long river going through Illinois. Okay, and we were right by the river where we used to live, and there was this big tree that fell straight into the river, and there was this one branch sticking out of it. Okay, and I'm like, that branch. So I waited until the river finally froze until February, and I walked out there and I put a big bison, one of those big
you can't miss it.
Sticking out of the eyes.
It is about 17 feet into the water. So you can't and then I waited till spring and then I set it loose.
That is awesome. So what did you rate that one? I'm curious.
Oh,
probably like a 3.5.
3.5, I think. Yeah, 3.5 like probably. Yeah.
It was an easy find. You just
You see it. You just can't get to it. People get all the time. Like, I saw it.
Yeah. Didn't count.
But you know how somebody got it? How somebody FTF'd it? They literally took a ladder, walked into the lake or into the river, set up the ladder, a 12-foot ladder.
Set the ladder up. Yep.
And got the cash.
Wow.
Oh my gosh.
So someone got the FTF.
It's way to do it.
Yeah, hey,
people will do worse things than that for FTFs, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah, really.
Sometimes that comes.
You're not mean and you don't like disable it every winter so people can't go get it.
No, I don't do that. No, Jesse's only gets hit in the winter time.
Well, what's funny is that water, they're like doing the drainage in that preserve, and so that it's
just mud.
There's no water right now.
You can walk right to it.
So you can just walk right out to it, and nobody's coming out to find it.
Yeah.
I don't know if
So yes, you do pay attention. So getting coming back around the long way.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
In Chicago, you absolutely pay attention to what time of the year, especially if you're placing, if it's an FU hide. You know, you really want to pay attention because, like, if you want to put something on an island, you want to wait until it's winter and you can walk right to the island. You know,
absolutely.
You know, get a boat and try and get over there, you know.
Are your reviewers pretty good about if you have it there and you have the page built, they won't let anybody put anything close in the area?
They'll hold it. You can submit them and, you know, don't publish this yet. Just, you know, submitting for approval. And they'll hold it. I think they have a time limit, though. Maybe
months,
like 3 months or something.
Like a couple months.
Something like that.
So if you go February by April or May, it's thawed. It's thawed by late March. It's, you know, anything that's frozen is not frozen anymore.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Or I wouldn't want to walk on it frozen.
You know? Right. Yeah. You don't want to take. You want to risk
frozen, but not thick frozen.
Right. Yeah. You don't. You know. You're not stepping foot on that. So.
Yeah. I'm still not comfortable walking on frozen ice, even though it freezes here thick enough for a truck to drive across. I grew up in the south, and you don't walk on frozen.
I'm all over it.
Water.
Yeah. I'm on it.
As long as there's, you know, fishermen out there, I'm okay with it.
Yeah.
Because I know
it still creeps me out. I've done it, but I don't like it.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Oh, I've walked where there was water like bubbling up.
Oh, sure.
Like, I was like, oh, Lord.
Oh, sure. You're walking out.
That's insane.
Yeah, you're slushing. It's getting slushy. And
But that's not how you need to make the paper.
Right. But again, you know, it's winter. You alter the way that you cache and what you carry in your pack. And we always have, you know, a rope and a solar blanket. And, you know, knock on wood, nothing's happened so far. So, you know.
Is the icon the attribute, some attributes you can do the whole does not thing. Does that one winter friendly? Could you do a slash through it?
Yes.
You can do not winter friendly. Yeah.
Right. Okay. Yes. Well, that makes it interesting too. It gives you more information.
Yep. If used right, because people like
if people use it correctly, we've found caches that way. But like, okay, it's up. You know, we know it's not on the ground.
Yeah.
Because it's not winter friendly. So.
How about flipping it around a little bit, cache maintenance. Do you guys and gal think
what is cache maintenance? I
don't know what is cache maintenance? Stop it.
That's what the community does, right?
There's an old saying, if the community doesn't maintain it, it's not worth being there.
Right. do you think about trying to do certain maintenance now versus like you're like, oh, we got to go fix that now. I don't want to wait till there's snow on the ground.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, definitely.
But I usually don't check things, honestly, most of my caches, unless I get a DNF from a reputable person or numerous DNFs, you know?
Yeah.
Because I have a bunch of FU hides where I know it's they just can't find
it. You know it's tough.
If something's got an FTF and I'm literally driving by it, I'll stop by and I'll be like, it's right there, you know, and I'll get back in my car. But like, usually, you know, my caches get hit. I put them in places where, you know, they're not going anywhere. I try not to put them in places where they're not going to go anywhere. They're not going to get muggled. You know, I'm usually shocked when they get muggled.
Yeah.
But
what's your kind of balance between regular hides and FU hides?
Most of mine are FUs now. my only regulars are like
milestone
hides. Those are my only regulars these days. But the other that's a nice FU hide.
Like challenge caches? You mean those kind? Do you do many challenge cache?
Put them out?
Yeah, put them out.
Oh yeah, I have. Well, yeah. I have what two? I think I have two challenge caches.
Two, I think that I can. Okay.
What about the AR caches? Did you put any of those out?
Not done that. No, I don't know how to set that up. Dude, I've been out of the loop for like 3 months, man.
Yeah.
That's true.
And it's almost over now. That one's almost over, too.
Like, when all that came out, like, I was knee-deep,
I don't think
man.
There's any around here at all.
Not that
I don't
I know
think
of.
Anyone's
no.
put any out.
No.
Have you guys done any?
I think, yeah, I've done a few.
Yeah.
Jesse, don't you have one?
I got three.
Yeah, see, I thought he had one.
Yeah. Yep. I've got – we each put one out real quick. We all kind of jumped on it and decided –
yeah.
Good or bad, we wanted to be first. So I got the first in Texas, and he's got the first in Colorado. And
is there no ICANN? Is it no ICANN or just
no?
It's just a temporary 3 month thing, and they're going to decide whether they're going to get rid of him or not at the end.
You have to make it an unknown. You have to make it the question mark. You know,
poo poo. I want an ICANN.
I know.
We talk to me when there's an ICANN, guys. Come on.
Absolutely.
I think it'll be after the challenge cache ICANN.
Right. God, if anything needs an ICANN, the challenge cache needs an ICANN.
Oh my gosh,
doesn't it? That and puzzles. It'd be nice to have a separate puzzle icon. But, I mean...
A field puzzle or like a regular puzzle?
Do you mean field puzzle?
Yeah, well, instead of an unknown, you separate unknown from puzzle.
Well, unknown is like...
Or
so
gadget.
Big.
Yeah, gadget would be kind of... Gadget cache.
Like how they broke down the event cache. You know, they got the event and then they've got the different kind of events, you know?
Yeah.
How you just won them. You know, like now it's
it could still be under that cat. Yeah, just like that.
Unknown and then have just different challenge categories. Yeah, like a challenge.
Yeah. I like that.
Good idea.
Yeah. They'll never do it. She always gripes at me whenever she sees my lost
icon. Lost and found icon. Well, we're coming up on 20 years.
I will never get it.
Maybe it'd be funny if the lost and found came out again for the 20 year and then you could get
that'd
it
be cool.
Then.
Yeah, they totally should do that.
You know.
That would be cool.
Yeah, to give those people who started in 2011 a chance to get it.
Right.
Yeah, no kidding.
By a year, that girl.
Yep.
That would be nice.
But then, like, I missed, like, the ape cache in Chicago by, like, 6 months. It went missing 6 months before I started caching.
Oh, yeah.
Oh,
at least you have the ape cache now?
No, I don't. No, that's on our list to do to get to Seattle. So, like, before that thing goes missing again.
I know.
Yeah, I went to Seattle, but it was before they brought the ape cache back out.
Oh, dude.
Thanks.
Sucks.
Now, of course, I did the headquarters tour, you know, and did all that stuff. And that's everybody needs to do that, you know, at some point, right, if you're doing it. Yeah. But I promise when I was in there, they go, oh, yeah, we got this committee that's working on where I go. It's updating that. That's been a couple years.
Yeah,
so
that's not happening.
I think that's just going to go defunct.
Yeah.
That sucks. I like a good where I go, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Done well. They're a lot of fun.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I've done a lot of good where I go, you know. Mm-hmm. Did you get a where I go this weekend?
I did not go in this
Did you
weekend.
Guys hear about Jessie did this weekend, the insanity that she did?
No, well, a little bit. I saw a couple of her posts, Facebook posts.
Where did you go with your child?
My son and I drove from home, Chicago, down to St. Louis Friday night, stayed overnight mm-hmm. Friday night, got up early Saturday morning, went up in the arch, so we got that virtual.
Yep.
Oh, nice.
We drove from St. Louis to Chicago in 2 days via Route 66.
Wow. That's cool.
So, yeah, mm. it was a lot of fun, but it was, you know, 48 hours, 700 miles.
How many caches did you get?
30. I got 30.
Break it down. What'd you get? Come on.
I got.
Wow. Come on, break it down.
I got.
She's got quite a few different kinds. Yeah.
Come on. I know you didn't get traditionals. Really. I know Jessie. She didn't get traditionals.
I did, actually. I did. I just dropped my pen. I got 24 traditionals.
Uh-huh.
I got 3 puzzles. One of those was the Route 66 challenge, which I got to sit back down and figure out if I even qualified for. And I don't even want to get into that. I'm so upset. I don't think I qualified. That was the whole point of the whole trip.
Oh, no.
2 virtuals and a letterbox.
You got 2 virtuals?
I got 2 virtuals. Yeah, oh, I got this the arch, and then I got one of the new ones.
One of the new ones.
Yeah, cool.
Very cool. Was it a letterbox hybrid, or was it a true letterbox?
It was a letterbox hybrid.
Oh, cool. Okay.
The very often abused icon type.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The letterbox hybrid.
Literally, she walked in the house like an hour ago. Like,
yeah.
Like we said hello, and that's about it. I've even barely heard about the trip. I went to dinner, and she told me a little bit about it, but I really haven't even heard about it. So honestly, I have no idea what she found. I have no idea.
Oh, cool. Yeah. All right. Well, we're going to wrap up for tonight. Let's kind of go around the room and kind of sort of give final thoughts on just the sort of what we call the end of summer geocaching. So I'll start with Memphis. What are some of your final thoughts on the topic tonight?
Well, I think it's interesting because people cache in such different ways. Like y'all don't, you know, mm-hmm. Scott, you and Jessie, y'all do it year round, no doubt. Yeah. There's definitely a big percentage of people in my area that drop off during the wintertime. Now it's some pretty harsh conditions, really? You know, too, but they'll still do some in town. They'll still go to the events and stuff like that, but you definitely see the numbers drop off.
They're still active cachers, right? They're active cachers. They're not.
Yeah, they're active cachers. They're not like part-time people.
Yeah, but they're literally going to switch their gears.
Yeah, they switch their gears a lot. They'll hit some, but it definitely shifts into the city. But we still go year-round. Ours is dictated by family. You know, if we have family events, we cache less. If we don't have family events, we cache more. But we don't let weather really stop us.
Yeah. Do you find older cachers maybe don't do as well, maybe in the harsher weather, so they're waiting more to the little better weather or is that
at least the backcountry stuff for sure.
Yeah.
But the urban stuff, you know, is they'll do those year round. But yeah, you definitely see a different type of caching in our area anyway during the summertime and during the wintertime.
Or if you don't have a Jeep, I guess if you don't have the right equipment to get to the
right. Yeah. Definitely equipment dependent on a lot of that stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, one of my busiest months is December.
That's cool.
One of my busiest months. December and January. Like, I don't know why, but that's like,
yeah.
A lot of it depends on what your family structure is. If you cache with your family, if you have kids, you know, and when your kids are occupied with stuff and.
Oh, of course. Yes. Like I say, it's kind of a big pain for us, you know, the kids get older. In about 5-7 years, it'll all be over.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, baseball will be all over.
All over.
The whole summer, Dave.
Just to go crazy.
So Scott, Jessie, you're kind of some of your final thoughts on
or
suggestions and thoughts.
Yeah, I mean, for me personally, end of summer is like when we get going, you know. I mean, mm-hmm. Last weekend I did a trip out to Ohio for the Midwest Geobat.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they had a huge day and that was a great time. Anybody who hasn't been out to Midwest Geobash, definitely check it out next year.
Right.
You know, big caching. Well, I mean, only 30 finds, but it was, you know, it was a big caching weekend for me this weekend. Next weekend we have West Bend Cache Bash coming up. So that's going to be a huge weekend for us,
right.
You know, and then I think as we go into the fall, we'll start planning for us, you know, because it gets so cold here in the winter, I think for us, like October, November, December is when we plan our trips to go down maybe to the southern part of the state where it's a little bit warmer. Like, you know, we're working on our county challenge. I think we have 15 counties left in Illinois, the DeLorme paid challenge, you know, those kinds of things that we've been saving the southern warmer part of the state. So, you know, I think maybe we'll hit that this winter, but you know, caching's just getting started for me.
Yeah, it's
it's ramping up. It's ramping up.
Aside from like a now and again, it's been pretty dormant. So we're looking forward to getting out there and going to West Bend, and that's when you get into the hundreds, you know. So
Yeah.
Did you happen to grab the Warrego when you're out of that last mega,
Jesse?
Which one? Yeah, the
one in Ohio. There was a brand new one that came out that week. Event
bash for the
event. Trivia, the where I go, you said.
Yeah.
So geocaching trivia.
Yeah.
Yes, I did get that. I actually cleared the fairgrounds this year. That's the first year that I've found all of the caches on the fairgrounds. So
let me guess who wrote that where I go.
Yeah, did you? Hold on. Did you like it? Because if not, never mind.
I did like it, but I didn't know. No. I actually did that
did
one.
You really?
That was one that I actually did.
Wow.
I might have.
Here we go.
Solved a few caches that I found the way that you're supposed to, but you know
that one you did.
My pen was on the log on those.
That's all that matters, man.
The where I go, I did do. But I didn't notice who did it. Whose was it?
Was it yours?
Maybe. No, I help a lot of people build them. We help build a lot of them for people who call real quick. Hey, we need a where I go, and nobody wants to build this crap. And some of us build that one out there. So
it wasn't the trivia one. That's not the one I'm thinking of. The trivia one was
the true, false, and the answer the questions for the area.
Yes.
Yeah, we built that one.
Okay. Yay. Yeah, that was cool. I did that.
I want to find out if it was any good before
free claim it. It was good. Yeah, I did that.
Yeah, I don't know who built that one.
Yes, I don't know who did that one. Some other person. Very cool.
Yeah, that was good.
But yeah, it's in terms of the end of summer. Yeah, I mean, like I say, that geocaching season doesn't end for us. So
yeah,
it's really
good.
It's just the end of just starting to change the way we cache. You know, I mean, fall is my favorite time of year for caching. So it's getting into end of summer. I mean, it's my favorite time. You know, fall, you got no spiders. You got no stick tights. You've got no. It's like the woods are pretty safe again in terms of.
Right.
Like getting crap on you.
The ticks disappear. Ticks
are gone. Just nice.
Ticks weren't that bad this year.
No, mosquitoes weren't bad this year.
Mosquitoes are gone. That's gone. You know, so that's really my favorite time to catch. Yeah. So I'm
awesome. Forward to it. Well, good deal. Yep. Well, awesome. Coming up on the show, we've got next week, hopefully we'll have whatever problems we had will disappear. We'll have to do some checking on that. But show 111, kind of a weird number, right? A good repeating number. We got on Electric Water Boy is going to be on. We're going to talk about puzzles, which I'm not really great at puzzles, so I need help. And so Tom Brotherman will be on Electric Water Boy to help us with that. In 2 weeks, John Bishop is going to come back on the show. He's our AMS Travel sponsor, and he's going to tell us about the geocaching trip they took up with the Alaskan cruise that they took a bunch of geocachers on. We'll talk about Costa Rica, Memphis.
So fingers crossed, but I don't know. I think I'm opting for Australia now.
Oh, okay. Switching gears for the Oz, the other mega. But anyway, we'll still talk about the different possibilities with AMS Travel. With John in 2 weeks, and then in 3 weeks Land Monkey's coming back on the show, and we're going to talk about his trip to Iceland and beyond, because he went to Iceland and Sweden and
do you follow him on Instagram?
Yes.
I swear, does that dude ever work?
no
I mean, every time he's out somewhere doing something.
Right.
No, love them up, but dude, go to work.
Right.
Want his job. What is he doing
right. for a living? What's he doing for a living?
So that's funny that you said that, because on LinkedIn, it says geocaching media person.
Dude,
on his LinkedIn, which is your business profile, right?
Right. That's his business profile.
How did he get that?
Right.
Where do we sign up for that job?
Exactly.
That dude never works.
And they're always in the most incredible like
maybe it's a Canadian thing. I don't know. Maybe it's not a US thing. I was talking to, Mark, my buddy in the UK.
Yeah,
you know, from
yeah. He, by the way, besmirched you today. I don't know if you knew that or not, but
what now?
He besmirched you. Jesse knew that. He was like, he complimented us. He's like, I'm so glad you're having Jesse on the show, but the other guy is a hack. You don't want to have him on.
Well, I saw him to Mark this morning because we do a little podcast. What's up, internet? I don't want to plug anything, but we do.
No, that's good. Yeah,
feel free to plug that show because it's
hilarious.
What's
up, internet? Yes,
not kid friendly.
Not kid-friendly.
It's UK version of Walt. And
explicit.
I'm talking to Mark, and Mark's like, "Yeah, I'm going to Cuba in a couple weeks." I'm like, "You're going to Cuba?" He's like, "Yeah, for 2 weeks." I'm like, "Wait a second, you're 2 week vacation? Who the hell gets 2 weeks?" Like, "Oh, we get a month." I'm like, "You get a month vacation?" I'm like, "That's starting." He's like, "Yeah, starting. You go to your job. Starting's a month." I'm like, dude, who goes? I hand to God, I've never gone on a 2 week vacation.
Right, and I haven't either. I can never get that much time off. Well, even if I built up that, yeah,
it's a little like Christmas break. But like as an adult, I've never gone on that. Me and Jesse just went on a week vacation like 2 years ago. Sorry, I say just Jesus, right. And like that was like the longest vacation I've taken in 10 years. You know, like 2 weeks he's going to Cuba. Yeah.
That's crazy. Well, back in the day, well, and Scott knows about this, if you're in IT, even if you got to, like, if you even built up 2 weeks and you go, even if you told me, like, I want to take 2 week vacation, like, yeah, no, you're not taking 2 weeks away.
You're not coming back.
You're not.
Yeah. We're gonna get
but I have 10 days of vacation built up. No, I don't care. You can't do that. You can't do that.
You can't leave for 10 days.
Right. No.
So yeah, I just think it's shocking that like maybe it's just the everything but the USA thing that these guys are just taking month vacations.
Oh yeah, that other countries get a lot more vacation standard. Just you know, that's not even like a huge perk. They get a lot more than we do.
You know, early in the year, Land Monkey, God bless you. I don't mean to rag on Land Monkey.
No, you're
early
fine.
In the year, he did that challenge to all the podcast hosts. You know, the thousand.
Oh yeah, to 1,000.
You know, we work for a living, dude.
Right.
You know, like, come on, man. It's not fair when you don't work.
Right. I think they get 6 months standard vacation in Canada.
Just start with. Like we
to start.
Yep.
I don't mean to rag on Land Monkey. It's just funny that I think he said invented. Does this cat ever work?
Right. Well, he was at Gigastock, and then he turned around, and I'm like, he's in Iceland. He's with Lange, you know, with the sharks. And
God bless him, man.
Sweden, Estonia. He made it all the way to Estonia, and I was like, wow. And like Scott said, it's like every other day he goes, yeah, here I'm here. I'm geocaching next to this waterfall, and I'm like. How is it that he just kind of gets out in the wilderness like every day? Yeah, I know. Every day he's like out at some sort of perfect place, you know.
And look at this view.
Right.
Hashtag suckers.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. I don't know what the poor geocachers are doing today.
we're apparently doing it wrong, is what we're doing.
Apparently. But all right. Well.
Me to stop you though.
No, you're good. Well, first of all, just thank you guys for coming on. I know we had kind of a weird geocaching thing. We'll have to do this again whenever we don't have bizarre things happen with geocaching. But I think we're okay with the.
We didn't pay our YouTube bill this month.
I guess not, but
I would stink at the show. Like, oh, the show didn't record.
We're good. We got it. Hey, the audio recorded. I don't know about the video. We'll have to check that later. But Scott and Jesse, thank you so much for coming on and. We're going to keep track of and definitely let us know whatever with Memphis and I can do to help. You know we're behind you guys 100%. So
and everybody visit shortyknits.com.
Shortyknits.com. There you go.
We can put a link to that too.
Yeah, we'll put the link in the show notes. So folks, we hope you enjoy the show tonight or the show that you're watching. Later, because you didn't get to watch it earlier. Email us your comments, not about Google. Email us your other comments at geocachetalk@gmail.com. Don't forget to follow us on Twitter at geocachetalk. Mine's at Gary Slinkard. We're doing a lot of Instagram lately. Geocachetalk, one word, or Memphis Mafia, one word. And of course, our Facebook page, facebook.com/geocachetalk. Show can be found on iTunes, Stitcher, TuneIn Radio, Google Play, as well as the Geocache Talk website. Don't forget to click on the subscribe button below and ring that bell. You like that? And that, it reminds you, yeah, so it reminds you of the show on a weekly basis, and tell your friends about the show. Don't tell them about tonight's, well, don't tell them about what happened tonight live. Tell them to watch this show.
Come start at 1:11.
Right. No, go back and watch this one. It was good.
Oh.
It was a good show tonight. We just, the live part was not as good. But
Live part's over, though, so now it's all downhill from here.
The great thing is YouTube will let you watch them over and over again, so we're looking forward to that. So, all right. Well, until next week, don't just talk about geocaching. Do what Scott and Jesse do, and that is actually go geocaching on a frequent basis. So good night, everybody.